Hi, everybody, and welcome to this evening's CBEC meeting. Folks are kind of filing in from the waiting room, so we'll give a few seconds before we kick things off. Right. My name is Nathan Sini. I am an architect with Morrison Hirschfield here in Seattle, a building science consultant, and the president of the Seattle Building Enclosure Council. And thanks everybody for coming out today. CBEC is a nonprofit that's dedicated to the pursuit of excellence in building construction and design. We want to make sure that everybody gets the latest information about how to build things better. CBEC works with a large board of folks to help us all out. We have Amelia Davis from Northwest Partners, who is our secretary. Jeff Didion is our treasurer. Amanda Pro, also with MH, is our education chair. If you have ideas for presentations or want to speak yourself in the future, please reach out to Amanda. Clifford Marvin is our membership chair. Hillary Roy does venues when we have those, which hopefully we will in the fall. Bill Thorderson is working both as our sponsorship coordinator and our student outreach person. So if you are interested in sponsoring future meetings, please reach out to Bill. And Bill will tell us a little bit more about the CBEC scholarships in a few moments. Grace Wong with OAC is our communication chair. Jeremy DeWitt with CDC runs our website. Penny Short is our board administrator. We merged with Spokane Beck. So Phil Martinson is our Spokane representative. And then Rob Bechtel is our immediate past president. Our next meeting coming up will be May 19th, and it's a lunchtime meeting. It will be called Environmental Facade Perspective, Designing a Sustainable Rainscreen Wall Assembly Aspiration Versus Actualization, which sounds like a dissertation title because it is Patricia Shaw's doctoral dissertation that she's going to present to us. And I also wanted to mention that in our June meeting, I think we have the woman who runs Building Science Fight Club, Christine Williamson, to give us a presentation that we're going to pin down the content of shortly. Other area events, CSI Puget Sound is having the fourth part of their Specifications 101 class on May 11th. IBEC Puget Sound has a chapter meeting on the 12th of May, and then their annual Doug Jason Golf Tournament comes up on August 26th. And I'd like to hand it off to Bill to kind of talk about the CBEC scholarship and then to introduce our scholarship winners.
Hi, thank you. Sorry, I'm not on. So just to talk about the scholarship a little bit, it's an annual scholarship, and it is two $2,000 scholarships for students that are currently enrolled in school. And initially, it would just seem like it was kind of like the UW and Wazoo, but we've reached out to more schools, Lake Washington, South Seattle, Central Washington, and just opened it up to those people too. And the outcome of what we've got is just some amazing, excellent students that are out there. And the construction industry is going to be a better place because of these students coming up. So, there's some criteria. They must be a member. They must be enrolled in school. And it's usually hard because we get, anywhere from 10 to 15 applicants. So we got to pare it down to just two. So one thing I'll throw out there too, is if you are, any of you are looking for internships paid or sometimes people just want to, do a free internship, let me know. We can connect. We get inquiries every once in a while from students that are looking for that. So, this year's winners are Marta Coca and Jacob Gunther. So I don't know, Nathan, if you want to turn it over to one of them to, if they're queued up to do their presentation and introduce themselves.
Yeah, Marta, take it away.
Good night, everyone. My name is Marta Coca, one of the awardees for the 2022 CIVEC Scholarship. I would like to take this opportunity to thank Seattle Building Enclosure Council for their generosity in funding this scholarship. I am very honored to be the recipient of this award. I am currently a sophomore in the Architectural Technology Program at Lake Washington Institute of Technology and a junior in the Sustainable Building Science Technology Program at South Seattle College. My goal is to graduate in June from Architectural Technology and next year from Sustainable Building Science Technology. I am a mature woman who, when I moved from Spain to the United States, I found a new opportunity to continue learning about construction in a sustainable way. Organizations like CIVEC, with their continuous learning, help students like me with further the pursuit of excellence in design, construction, or other technical aspects of the building enclosure. Receiving this scholarship motivates me to continue striving to maintain my GPA and improve my knowledge to build in a more sustainable way. I look forward to being able to give back to the community once I start working on sustainable construction projects. I thank CIVEC for their confidence and willingness to help me achieve my goals. As well, thank you very much for inviting me to this webinar, where I look forward to learning strategies and approaches to designing with architecturally exposed concrete. Thank you very much.
Well, thanks, Marta. Jacob, do you want to speak up?
Yeah, sure. First off, can everyone hear me okay? Awesome. So thank you so much to this group. This is an incredible honor to be selected for this award. It truly means a lot. Everyone else, my name is Jacob Gunther, and I'm a third year undergraduate student at the University of Washington studying construction management, and I'm minoring in architecture. I grew up just north of Seattle in Edmonds, so some of you might be familiar with really great views of the Cascades, the ferries, and maybe travel guru Rick Steves. But during my relatively short time here, I've seen a lot of changes. And moving down to Seattle 2 years ago to start college and looking at that skyline, it's really hard to not want to be a part of the city's explosive growth. So, you know, going back to my childhood, I guess what really drew me to construction is Legos, Lincoln Logs. Those things seem pretty cliche, but those small things helped me develop an appreciation for the built environment and seeing those things come together. So I'm at UW and I really look forward to continuing my studies with the end goal of working in the construction industry after graduating. And right now I'm learning about cross-laminated timber. I'm particularly interested in that, but you know, today I know we're gonna talk about concrete, architectural concrete. So it is the most common building material in the world. So I'm learning a lot more about that right now. So those are kind of my interests, but I want to learn how to build for a future that adapts to all these important goals that we have. There's a lot of climate pressures. There's new housing pressures, and we live in a really attractive area in Seattle for that. So I want to be able to build beautiful and but very practical things with those goals in mind. So again, I really want to thank you for your vote of confidence. It truly means so much to me. And my anticipated graduation date is 2023, and I'm really interested in what I'm studying. So your financial support means so much to me. I really appreciate it. Thank you.
Well, thanks to you both. We look forward to seeing what you guys get up to in the future. Now, our sponsor this evening is Mike Fletcher, who is a technical services manager with ePro. But that's not the right. Mike, what is the? Oh, it's the one behind you there. How do I get that on?
Keep
the
going. Hey, look.
Okay. That's pretty. Oh, there we go. Okay.
That's better. Thank you, Nathan. Yeah, no, I appreciate the opportunity to sponsor tonight's lecture. And big thank you to the CBAC volunteer team, you know, month after month after month with a summer break, I guess. It's consistently a good lecture, and well, the food's always good too during COVID. But I really do appreciate the opportunity, and thanks to the team that puts this together every month. A lot of emails, I bet, a lot of phone calls, a lot of meetings. So thank you, you guys. Some of you might be familiar with EPRO and some of you might not, but we have really grown up in the last few years. We've taken 30 years of below-grade waterproofing and applied it to, you know, the demands of a modern-day construction site. So, I think quickest way to show you what we've been doing is show some of the customers. Can everyone see my slide? Fantastic. Last 30 years, we've been working with a lot of different manufacturers. We've done fast food restaurants, large industrial parks, senior living facilities, five-star hotels, shopping malls, museums. We've done it all, right? So we're very proud. I have a couple of quick slides and a short video. During the video, I really would request that everyone has their audio on. It's kind of fun. But different types of building protection. You got bentonite, you know, which works with, comes in contact with water and expands. You got sheet membranes out there that repel the water. You got fluid applied, which is applied in the field, and composites, where you take a combination of different systems and build them in the field. What EPRO brings to the table is redundant composite systems. We have membranes, we have hot rubber, we have polymer rubber gels for renovation work, bentonite sheets for sure, and vapor intrusion. So contaminated sites, we're one of the leaders in the country with VMIs. Drainage composites, water stops, grout injection, we got it all. But we're coming out with a new product, our pre-tack, which is a pressure sensitive HDPE, and we have a dual lap seam. So I have a quick little video. Thank you for the opportunity to present. At the end is my kind of contact info. You can reach out to me directly or in the chat, I guess. But thanks again for the opportunity.
All right, so what's the name of this product?
What you're seeing here today is EPRO Pre-Tack with dual adhesive seams.
Which can be done underwater. So today we're doing it in muddy water.
Muddy water. Salvage edge to salvage edge. Don't litter.
Sample that we stuck yesterday in the mud in the muck. So we did this at 11:44 a.m. So that means we are at 22 hours right now. So 24 hours is the full cure time for this product. So we're a couple hours early. Let's see how she did. Yeah, I'm stuck on you. Got this feeling down deep in my soul that I just can't. Guess I'm on my way. This is stuck pretty well. I am pretty impressed.
Hey, so thank you very much, you guys. And thanks to Jason and Joe and Dave at Excel Pacific to let me play in their mud puddle. Appreciate it. Looking forward to the presentation.
Awesome. Thanks, Mike. So, our presentation tonight. Oh, first, this is a new slide. I remembered to add it this time. We're using the Zoom webinar format, which means that the participants stay muted and off video throughout. It's just the panelists that you see on your screen that are able to kind of speak and screen share and do all that stuff. But we would love to hear your questions. So please use the Q&A function in your Zoom window. It's a little like dialogue bubbles next to the chat. Send those through. All the panelists will be able to see them. And then I will bring them to Brad's attention as appropriate, as I can squeeze them in. And that's a great way to participate. And then we'll try and do some more conversation after the presentation, if we all have time. Our topic tonight is Brutal Honesty, Architecturally Exposed Concrete in the Pacific Northwest. And it's presented by Brad Carmichael. Brad is an engineer and a certified passive house consulting, working with 4EA, formerly JRS, up in the Lakeview neighborhood of Seattle. And Brad, you are welcome to take it away.
All right, thanks, Nathan. Hey, I'm really glad to be here. Let's just see if I can get my screen share to work real quick, and we'll dive right in. All right, is that working, Nathan?
Yep, looks good.
Perfect. All right. So I'm gonna do a bit of a talk on architecturally exposed concrete. I'm gonna highlight some things in the Pacific Northwest. This is my first time doing this presentation, so everyone's patience is appreciated. The other disclaimer is I'm currently watching my kids as well, so they might pop in, but we'll see how it goes. What we're gonna talk about tonight is a little bit of discussion in favor of architecturally exposed concrete, some discussion of the control air considerations with that medium, some design strategies and tips and detail-oriented things, some approaches to the limitations on its durability, ways to rehabilitate it, and then we're going to flip the other side and have some things against exposed architectural concrete and come full circle. All right, the first slide I'll do is, this is an AIA approved presentation. So I will keep going with that. One second here. All right. So why the intrigue of exposed concrete? This presentation kind of came about from earlier discussions with some staff. You know, exposed concrete, especially a certain era of exposed concrete, is a little bit contentious. You know, there's a lot of people choose kind of Roman concrete as a starting point for discussion, but I really like the mid-century brutalism as a starting point. It's these buildings need more love, so I just want to highlight them a little bit. This is probably one of the first generally considered brutalist buildings, the Unit d'Habitation, designed by Le Corbusier. And so when we hear the term brutalism, it actually comes from the term béton brut, which basically was Le Corbusier saying, we're gonna leave the concrete exposed and raw. And so the other sort of starting point for it, and this is just to bring some love to the type of building, was an early sort of article from Rainer Banham about what's called the new brutalism, right? And how these buildings were a little bit different than a lot of other modern buildings happening at the time. And I think it's important to highlight. So these buildings, and you'll see the one here is not actually exposed architectural concrete. And it's become, you know, since then, brutalist buildings have become ubiquitously exposed architectural concrete. But really what it comes down to is the idea is that these buildings are made of what they appear to be made of, right? They're not wrapped in anything. They're exposed, there's no pretension to be something other than what they are. This building looks like it's made of glass, brick, and steel, and is in fact made of glass, brick, steel, and concrete. So this adherence to honesty in structure and a material is sort of the core value behind this sort of mid-century movement of exposing the structure, being honest to its make. And I think that's a really important thing, something that means a lot to me. So things being as they appear is really important. And I think that brutalist buildings kind of get a bad rap, but they're pretty cool buildings. So these are some of the highlights from around the country and in France. But you can see they're not all the same. They're not all bland. Some of the origins of the brutalist buildings were to express kind of monumentality and confidence in the world rebuilding after the Second World War, valuing our institutions. And since then they've come to mean a lot of different things, but we also have to be aware that we're looking back on pretty recent memory. And, I went through phases of not liking 80s music and then liking 80s music, and tastes change. There's no reason why we can't look at these buildings with a different eye and see, not something that's necessarily alienating or cold and boring, but actually something that's pretty beautiful and kind of neat. We do have some cool examples here in the Pacific Northwest. Freeway Park. Freeway Park is a really neat park. My kids like jumping around on it. It's really neat to be inside. There's a lot of cool exposed concrete buildings at the University of Washington. I think we do have some really good examples of brutalist architecture here in the Pacific Northwest. The reason I start with honesty and highlight that in this presentation is a central core of being honest and brutally honest is acknowledging shortcomings. Okay, this is from a building I worked on in the Northeast, and it did not fare well. So. Despite the best intentions, a lot of these buildings mid-century that were built with exposed architectural concrete were not as long-lasting or monumental as the designers intended. But also a big part of it is they're not getting the love they need, and they are going vacant and unmaintained and demolished. And that's another big part of the reason behind why we need to show some love to these buildings. So. Prentice Women's Hospitals, a Bertrand Goldberg building, hospital in Chicago, super cool building, demolished, right? They just recently, Girls Welcome Center is supposed to be North Carolina. But that was a building that was just demolished like within the past year. In the Orange County Government Center, there was big, huge campaigns to save it in upstate New York, and it's been demolished. And then the sort of famous early brutalist building, Robin Hood Gardens, also demolished. And so there's a lot of these buildings are on the chopping block. They're being demolished and replaced with newer buildings, not necessarily more durable buildings, not necessarily better buildings. And so there's a need to show these buildings some love. And in doing that, that's what I'm hoping to do. So what do we have? What does that have to do with us, right? We're building enclosure consultants, we're building scientists. What do we have to learn from brutalism? A lot of us learn from failure, and a lot of us learn from, mishaps and the lessons learned, right? But ultimately, brutalist buildings were meant to be monuments, meant to be things that last and perform, and that's something that we want to do as well. We need to learn from our past failures. So, I think here in the Northwest, me in particular, I learned a lot from the Vancouver leaky condo crisis. What happened to all those condos in Vancouver ended up teaching me a lot about buildings and what their limits are and how they fail. We also need to learn how to be honest and make corrections with buildings. And then think about them on longer timescales. I like the idea of thinking of buildings as monuments, thinking of buildings as something that's gonna last forever. And when we translate to the type of construction we're working on today, I think these are important because when we look at how we're constructing things, there's a lot of lessons learned from, you know, the early buildings, and that might translate to the risks that we're taking right now. So, you know, one thing that we're doing today is we're building with less craft and less tradition, right? So we're not building, we didn't go backwards into pre-modern times. We are still building with new materials all the time without a long history of tradition behind them. So new materials every day onto the markets, new materials with different chemistries, different makeups, shorter track records. We're doing that in the same way that the, you know, or mid-century moderns were working with materials that were new and didn't have these traditions. Today, we're optimizing mechanical systems. We're not overheating our buildings the way we used to when we'd have a big cold-fired furnace in the basement, and we're adding more insulation. We're also making our buildings more airtight. So in a way, we're building like we've never built before, right? And then on the flip side of that, we also now have higher expectations for our buildings. Everything's performance driven. We're trying to be less wasteful. We're trying to build with faster schedules. We're trying to put more value add into everything we do. We're trying to justify everything we do in design. And as a part of that, we're taking on more risk. So today we're still building like we haven't before, and we're doing it with less margin of error. And that's something to sort of keep in mind and sort of learn, well, how does that translate to the lessons we've learned from buildings like brutalist buildings, the lessons from the moderns who were taking risks and learned that maybe these buildings don't last forever, and how do we approach that? You know, one thing that we've all learned as, you know, enclosure consultants and building scientists is that control layers are important. I'm not going to review this because I'm preaching to the choir here, but we know our four control layers. So let's look a little bit into how concrete buildings handle their control layers. So I like to always, whenever exposed architectural concrete comes up in design meetings, I like to always kind of preface the conversation by saying, you know, concrete itself is actually quite a watertight material. There's just exceptions, right? It doesn't leak except for the cracks. It doesn't leak except for the cold joints, the form tie holes, the penetrations, the rock pockets, the transition details, areas of unconsolidation. There are actually, a lot of reasons why or conditions where concrete leaks, but the material itself, okay, sure, it's kind of watertight. But if you can eliminate all of these other variables, you are left with a watertight material. The funny thing is the way you've placed concrete is also really important. Not all concrete is the same. So threw in some emojis, we're having fun here, it's after 5 o'clock. Shotcrete is, if you're doing exposed concrete, we've done it with shotcrete and it has worked, but it is probably not my first choice for a placement method for exposed concrete. Cast in place concrete, certainly a lot better. You get better consolidation. You get your cold joints are less of a risk because you're not just spraying the joints. Your form tie holes are a little bit more of a challenge. Penetration is about the same. Rock pockets are better. Transition details are about the same. Precast, however, precast is a pretty good material to use as an exposed architectural element, right? It's done offsite in a plant. So crack control is much, much more refined. So you're usually using panel sizes that don't have the same amount of shrinkage. You're not dealing with cold joints. You don't have the same levels of form tie holes because they're pouring them horizontally. Precast does have its drawbacks. It's not a perfect material, right? So there's still a lot of penetration risk, especially because most penetrations end up being cored rather than cast in. You get much better consolidation on your panels, and but the transition detailing can also be something difficult. There's also a bunch of different approaches to achieving a water control layer. So usually with concrete, you know, the starting point is the concrete itself, you know, controls is reasonably watertight, right? So incrementally, depending on your level of risk, you'll want to add different layers or different approaches to establish a control layer for water. There is probably the more durable way, but the most costly way is the split assembly, right? You cast it twice, or you cast a barrier in between. And we'll take a look at that in a little bit. It's very reliable. It costs a lot, but if you want to have exposed concrete that lasts and doesn't leak, that is a durable and reliable way to go. If there's ever a problem with the membrane, it's not that easy to maintain, but it certainly does the trick. Then there's admixtures. Many of us are familiar with the hydrophobic admixtures and the hydrophilic admixtures. The hydrophobic makes the concrete repel water. The hydrophilic ones are often like the crystalline admixtures that, there's several big manufacturers of those that have crystal growth that fills in or reacts with the free lime to fill in the pores of the concrete and create a watertight structure. There's a surface applied control layer, which we often see, and it is often used after the fact. That's the elastomeric paints. It's got its benefits, not the most visually appealing of the water control layers, but certainly a viable option. The cheapest and easiest is doing penetrating sealers with water stops, but it is not that great for its reliability and durability. It tends to have to be replenished after a few years. It doesn't bridge cracks. It doesn't, it doesn't seal around penetrations. So the penetrating sealers are typically only waterproofing the parts of the concrete that are already waterproof in a lot of respects. The other approach is the negative side slurries. Again, crystalline slurries that can be applied to the backside. They're pretty cost effective. They're so on reliability. Not that great to maintain because usually they're adjacent to a finished space. Just to give a sense of, what some of these look like. This is a split assembly where you can kind of see the picture on the top left, where we've got, you've got the first cast wall and then a fluid applied membrane goes on. Continuous insulation goes in between. There's rebar separating the two pores, and then the outer cast wall with the board form finished is poured after the fact. So then you've got a membrane that sits behind the exposed concrete that you can then tie in your windows to and your other assemblies to. The membrane's protected. It's usually really seeing very little water, but in the event that water does ever get back there, you've got a solid barrier. So that's sort of the split assembly approach. Very robust if you want to keep your concrete exposed and want to make sure that you've got a building that's going to last for a long time with its exposed concrete. The other approach is this is a photo for the hydrophobic admixtures. We get a lot of questions over, do these really work? Do they not work? Because you can't really see it. I like this one. This is part of a fountain water feature. Where we had hydcrete walls and you go around and hydrophobic admixtures essentially waterproof up to the thickness of a business card. So if you're anticipating more cracking, which sometimes we are, you'll probably want a little bit more of a membrane system. But if you're really going to have small shrinkage cracks that are smaller than the width of a business card, the hydrophobic admixtures do a pretty decent job. So here we've got a couple feet of water permanently on the backside of the crack, and you can see that it hasn't been leaking. This is just on a walk by after the building's been occupied for probably 2 years at that point, and the fountain's been on and full. And even where it cracks, the hydrophobics do tend to do a pretty good job and then do give you that look of raw, exposed, honest concrete. Then there's the elastomerics, right? If you're going to expose concrete, then you've got kind of the different looks there from a mock-up of the kind of opaque looking elastomeric coating. These will come either silicones or acrylics. But then you can also get some silicones that are clear, but we do like to set the expectation with clients that while it is clear, it's not quite the same as uncoated concrete, right? It's kind of got that sort of hair gel sheen to it that you can kind of see. It goes from basically a matte finish to a gloss finish. But there are ways to to make it look good. And it still does look like concrete when it dries. And elastomeric coatings, they do provide some crack bridging. They're right there on the surface so you can maintain them. They do the trick if you need your exposed concrete to be watertight. That said, you know, it does kind of fly in the face a little bit of the sort of leave it as found raw concrete look. So we appreciate that and know that the coated concrete look is not for every project. The crystalline slurries are a negative side waterproofing. Like any negative side waterproofing, I feel like they're not always the most reliable, but they do, you know, they will eventually kind of crystallize and form a waterproof barrier on the inside. So this is an example of an area where some patching was done at some cracks. This was kind of after the fact. The crystalline slurry was applied at cracks and then along cold joints, and you can see the crystals forming there and forming that sort of watertight plug after water is applied to the building. So there's other things to talk about beyond control layers when we're talking about mass walls and architecturally exposed concrete. I also want to say I find a way to get a picture of my kids into every presentation I do. So these are my kids. This is actually from a few years ago. This is just near my old hometown, a place off my hometown in Nanaimo. This is a place called Gabriel Island, and they have these beautiful sandstone. They call them the galleries. And what it is the sandstone has eroded over, you know, tens of thousands, maybe even millions of years with the rising and falling tides. And that's eroded the concrete or eroded the sandstone and created these big, huge arches, right? But I like that this photo exemplifies a few things. For one, my kids are under a shelter, right? So we've got the four Ds that are beyond the control layers. We call it the first D being deflection. And that's really important when you've got a material that doesn't necessarily handle water very well. The overhang protection keeps water off the walls. It's a good way if you are gonna expose your raw concrete to protect it from wind-driven rain, to protect it from getting too wet all the time. You can see here that this area's got drainage and you know, it's a poor material selection. It's sandstone, but it has eroded, but it's lasted for, you know, millions of years at this point. You can see the water drains out. The arches provide some drainage. This isn't a very, it's very important that at the high points where the kids are, it remains dry. And if you've got no water getting back that far and the water's always shedding away, these are important considerations for how to place or where to place your concrete on a building. Drying is also important. Making sure that once something gets wet and the water drains away, that it can dry out eventually, especially with the application of heat. And then durability. And this is another lesson with sandstone. Sandstone, not that durable, at least out here. You can see that the rising and falling of water over time will eat away the stone. Concrete can still even seem monumental, but just get eroded and beaten up by water over time. There are very few things that kind of outlast the constant contact with water, and not many of them are available at a construction budget for, you know, perpetuity. So that's sort of the water control layer considerations. Let's talk a little bit about insulation approaches when we're dealing with mass concrete in an exposed condition. So this is right out of the old Precast Concrete Institute handbook, and they kind of give you these are the three ways to insulate your exposed precast concrete. The first one on the left is leaving a gap and then providing bat insulation just within your stud cavity and then gypsum on the inboard side. So that purpose of that airspace is to provide a spot to kind of dry out the condensation that you're inevitably going to get. So it's not the best way to go. The more common practice that we see here is you having that solid barrier of foam insulation, airtight insulation, right on the backside of your of your exposed concrete. And that's a little bit more common practice here, be it below grade walls, stem walls, or exposed precast or exposed architectural concrete. The more efficient approach is the split level. And when budget allows, you know, that allows you to get a little bit more continuity in your insulation throughout. It's especially on higher buildings. We've looked at it in pricing for like precast sandwich panels, and because you're moving the furthest edge of the concrete out further, and the concrete's not all in one mass, the connections design of these types of precast panels gets pretty elaborate. But they are an efficient way, and if you're doing sort of lower rise buildings where the panels aren't that high in the air, you can often, and you're not working with a steel structure, these panels can be pretty efficient. So I got the frowny face on the interior bat. So we're going to just take a look at, just walk through kind of why this doesn't work so well in fairly high level approaches. So concrete, if you don't have it insulated, but you have a heated space on the inside, these are the kind of old warehouse buildings that don't seem to have the, you know, all the same problems if they're uninsulated, but still heated. You'll see that obviously your temperature from the outside rises steadily through a monolithic material till it reaches the inside, right? So the inside temperature, if you've got the heat on, it's cranking, it's, you know, it's warm inside, your inside temperature is actually going to track the inside slightly lower than the inside temperature of the interior space, and you're not necessarily going to have all of that much of a condensation risk. And then you're also just driving heat, you know, in these older buildings before we insulated them well, you're also just driving heat into the wall, which then, you know, drives the moisture outward. But once you insulate, you know, obviously the moisture balance changes, okay? Your temperature rise through the concrete becomes slower. And generally speaking, most of the change in temperature happens through the insulation layers. And as a result of that, your inner surface of the concrete layer, that surface temperature drops. If you don't have airtight insulation like this interior bat insulation from the precast manual, and you're in a cold climate, that air can then convect through behind, just bypass the insulation, and be prone to condensation. And there have been, you know, there have been some buildings that have needed pretty substantive retrofits because of this phenomenon, and it, largely in cold climates. And it certainly is a thing to consider. And that's why, you know, if you're not going with the split assembly, the rigid foam is a pretty decent approach. It does rely a lot on workmanship, but it does, you know, it does do the trick in preventing condensation. You can sort of see here, you've got a similar temperature profile, but then what you're doing with the rigid foam is you're creating an air barrier that prevents the interior moisture laden air from accessing the backside, the cold backside of the concrete, and condensing, and essentially becomes a system that has, through its airtightness, mitigates that risk of condensation. It's not perfect. There are different types of insulation you can use on the backside. We've seen spray foam, we've seen cut and cobbled foam where you're putting up boards and you're spray foaming the joints. There's others also seen a lot of taping and sealing. Different methods doesn't have the same problematic history that the bat insulation alone has. So it's pretty reliable. It's been pretty reliable in our climate and on our projects. While we're talking, the sort of thermal barriers for and the insulation approaches to mass walls and to exposed concrete, it's important to talk about our code targets for our energy code, especially with our newest code. So there's a few new things that have come into the 2018 Seattle Energy Code, specifically related to mass walls. The mass transfer deck slab edge has its own callout. It had its own callout in the last code round, but now we've also added the line item in our U value targets for the slab penetrating thermal envelope wall. And so that I'll just kind of walk through how those work and how they, you know, what they mean and, you know, how close are our targets, what you actually get out of them. So first thing we'll take a look at is the mass transfer deck slab edge, right? So that's basically your podium deck. If you're landing a concrete wall or a stem wall on a podium deck where the structure extends out past your insulation, it's pretty hard to get continuous insulation between your, let's say your underside garage ceiling insulation and the insulation on the backside of your wall, or even if you're using a split assembly, unless you buy get a structural thermal break there, it's pretty hard to get continuous insulation. So what the code's done is, you know, it's acknowledged that difficulty and provided some leniency, I guess, for designers to use a less robust detail here. But like the thing is even at a U value of 0.20, it's still intended to be somewhat punitive, right? So let's just assume we have a 10-foot wall. This is kind of just an example run through. 10-foot high wall, 8-foot thick concrete, you know, your target clear wall value being 0.057, but then the target that they give you when you're doing your U value calculations is 0.2. So that gives you about an effective U value of 0.074. And what that is, the reason I'm taking that, looking at that as sort of mid height is because by mid height and above, you're being influenced by the slab edges. So really just at the podium decks, at the transfer decks, you're kind of looking at how this is effectively mid height of wall downward. And that ends up being your code target is an effective 0.074, right? So when you look at the code default for the slab edges, they have these procedures. They're not the greatest, but there's a whole appendix in the back of the code to look up the default values for the slab edges. And it tells you that slab edge is 0.74. The effective U value for that sort of mid height to down is about 0.119. So just by designing like this, you're looking like you're about 61% above target. This is kind of, you know, we talk about this a bunch in our office. This is the like code compliance for code compliance sake approach. And, you know, there's of course two different ways to look at how we're documenting code compliance, but also how we're acknowledging thermal bridging. And then the other method, the method that, you know, we all feel is a little bit more reflective of real world performance is the linear transmittance method, right? So there's, you know, our peers over at Morrison Hirschfeld and have done a lot of work on this, but also our peers in the industry, and it's been driven by ASHRAE research, is the approach of using linear transmittance and the kind of principle of superposition of how much does this thermal bridge along a line impact your overall U value, and how much do you deduct based off of actual finite element analysis therm models, and what does it mean in real world numbers. So you know, based on the thermal bridging guides and the information that's available, this detail probably has what's called a psi value of 0.449, right? And just, again, we're going kind of high level at this, but what ends up happening is your effective U value here is about 0.136. And so we're still above target, more so than what these code tables do. So when we're, even though we've got a sort of a tabulated approach to account for these thermal bridges, in reality, they're a lot more generous than the real world performance of some of these details. So, high level, you've got a target of 0.2, you're going to end up doing your calculations, you're gonna be about 61% above target, but in real world, you're gonna be about 21% or 84% above target. So that's a pretty big shortfall when you're talking, you know, whole wall effective U values. There's other details though, right? So looking at another one, when you've got exposed architectural concrete, this is a common one. So you're insulating the inboard side of your mass wall, and then you've got your slab edge without a thermal break that goes right through. And so this is where the new code has provided another new target with another generous kind of allowance of the slab penetrating the thermal envelope wall. So this is kind of an expression of how that looks. Again, walking through this, not expect, you know, 620, not expecting anyone to be, calculating, going through the numbers too much, but really the target effective U value is like about a 0.06. And that's kind of mid height to mid height for your walls, your bands around your buildings where your slab edges are for exposed architectural concrete. The code default at the slab edge is about 0.741. The code procedure, just following their method that's written in the code, gives you an effective 0.1. So you're again about 67% above target. So you've got all of these like above, like all of these penalizing assemblies, whenever you go down these roads of exposing concrete, when you look at it from the linear transmittance side, to account for the thermal bridging, you know, you end up with about a similar target, but that's really just looking at just the slab edge, and not looking at, again, the impacts of openings and all of these other things. So just slab edge to slab edge, the code tables are fairly reasonable, but then looking at things like transfer decks and other details, once that's accounted for, again, the code procedures tend to be a little bit too generous. But yeah, there are some instances where the code procedures gives a reasonably accurate approximation of what the thermal bridging from the slab edge is. If you look at a precast slab edge, that's about the same height. One of the benefits with precast, whether it's a split precast unit or just a precast unit where you're insulating the inboard side, one of the benefits of that is that you do have a gap at the slab edge because you do have the steel hardware. So with this detail, there's a space for you to put insulation to give you that thermal break. There you've got a target U value of 0.07, slab edge U value of 0.07. If you're able to fit in an inch of fire safing on there, your effective U value is about 0.065. So you're really only above 14% above the code target. So what it is that when you're looking at designing the buildings, you're going to have a much easier time kind of hitting your code targets with the precast walls that are offset from your slab edges than you are with sort of cast in place walls that are bound to your slab edges without thermal breaks. The other approaches were you're hitting 60% above target, you're hitting 80% above target, but your envelope's a little bit closer to what we're trying to effectively do when we're working with precast, at least on paper. But then once we start looking at the linear transmittance, again, you can see the past value for the linear transmittance of a slab edge was about 30% more for the connected slab. But still, we're still pretty high above target once you look at the real world performance of these precast slab edges. The big takeaway here is that on paper, precast will get you a lot closer to your code targets. It'll seem a lot more like thermally efficient because you can get some fire safing in there. But once accounted for using the linear transmittance method, it's really not a whole lot better, but it is marginally better. So the code procedures you have that we have in Seattle, they probably underestimate the amount of thermal bridging that would be happening even if we're doing a precast wall with an inch of fire safing at the slab edge. But then we look at the sandwich. Okay, if you take the sandwich precast We've got target of 057. If we can get that 1 inch of fire safing, our effective U value is pretty much still 057, because we've still got all of our continuous insulation, and then we've still got fire safing, but that fire safing is not displacing your continuous insulation. It's really just displacing the bat insulation that's inboard, which is largely ineffective anyways. So generally, if you can do these split slabs, you're meeting your code target, these split panels, you're meeting your code targets out of the gate, which is pretty nice if at least from a code perspective. When you're looking at the linear transmittance, again, the linear transmittance at this type of detail is basically 25% of what it was with cast in place walls, and about a third of what it was for an inboard insulated precast walls. So your effective U value is really only about 20% above target. So that's a lot better. So there is a distinct advantage to these sandwich walls when it comes to achieving more realistic, not perfect, but at least more realistic mitigation of thermal bridging, and getting your effective U value in the real world, it's getting a lot closer to what you're showing on paper for your code compliance. The code procedures still underestimate the amount of thermal bridging, but that's largely because you generally show on paper that this assembly has continuous insulation and meets it all the way. So, again, using the emoji scale, which is our extremely scientific scale, we'll look at how these cast in place walls where your slab's connected it's not as good. We're pretty good once you get to precast, but there is a distinct advantage, at least thermally, with the sandwich panels. The other interesting thing with the new 2018 code is there are some prescriptive requirements that we don't need to use if we're doing a C407 approach, like an energy model. But if we are using a prescriptive or a UA approach, we have to take the location of any storefront or anything that's sitting on a concrete wall into account. And I'm open to hearing other interpretations of this new code language. But the way I read it, it makes it really, really hard to place something like storefronts in an exposed concrete opening, right? So the one we've kind of used a lot or seen a lot in the 2015 code was the one on the left there, where you've got a support inboard of the concrete, you move your frame back, it kind of sits over the continuous insulation. You're reasonably aligned, but there's still some thermal bridging because you're kind of sitting over top of the concrete there, right? So that achieves kind of item one, where the code is basically asking you to make sure that the thermal break that you have in your frame is aligned within 2 inches of your continuous insulation. So that checks the box for number one. Same, number two is still kind of similar, but where that detail falls short is now the code is asking us to, that if the exterior face of our fenestration frame, it doesn't extend to the exterior face of the opaque wall's rough opening, which is the outside edge of the concrete, then you need to cover the concrete with an insulating material or some wood. So leaving the concrete exposed in the top left doesn't really meet that prescriptive requirement. And there doesn't seem to be, other than doing a whole building energy model, there doesn't seem to be a prescriptive way out of this from the detailing perspective. If you move your storefront all the way to the front, you then are no longer within 2 inches of your continuous insulation. So you don't achieve goals one and two. It's really the split insulation assemblies that hit all of these targets, because you can have your fenestration a little bit up forward, have it close, at least close enough with the, actually should have moved it even further, but you can have it close to the front face of the of the concrete, and you can align your glass within 2 inches of a centrally located insulation and achieve items 1, 2, and 3. It seems like a bit of a cumbersome requirement from the code, but it is nevertheless what's in there.
Hey, Brad, we've got a question about using a thermally broken kind of slab edge. Does that differ from kind of what you were talking about with the precast pieces?
Yeah. No, the thermally broken slab edges are fantastic. And that's kind of going back to what I was talking about earlier is you can do those, and we have been seeing those on projects. And a lot of the times it is we've seen them both the sort of like the pre-manufactured ones, and we've also seen when it's not that structurally not that like important structurally of actually just pouring sort of high compressive strength insulation through the when having rebar going all the way through. Certainly that is one way of addressing those conditions. And we'll probably be seeing a lot more of those approaches happening locally. I think, you know, up in Vancouver, there definitely seem to be a lot more common than what we're seeing here. We're often more often than not, we're seeing you know, teams taking the hit on those prescriptive code requirements and you know, making it up for it somewhere else. But if you do have high high aspirations as far as your enclosure targets go, those pre-manufactured thermal breaks are a good way to go. The next sort of control layer we're just going to talk about briefly. I think we talked a little bit about the insulation, but with precast, the interesting way to look at it is that we often use the two-stage joints, where that interior sealant joint is your water control layer, but also your air control layer. And just to give a couple of examples of some projects where it's important because these walls, these mass walls, rely on these joints as a control layer to really trace out and make sure you're hitting all the connections. So that one on the top left, we've got that interior air seal joint at our precast joints. And then at the bottom where we hit the stem wall, this particular detail has spray foam continuously on the backside of precast. And that creates an air seal down at the base where we have an upturned basically trough of waterproofing that they then sealed that along to create the air seal connection back to the air and vapor barrier that's down at the roof assembly. Detail on the right, you'll also see this is this is a head detail. For a unitized curtain wall system, you need clearance at the head in order to lift the unitized curtain wall system into place. So what you'll see is that we end up having, you know, about a 3-inch, 3.5-inch gap at the top. Then you got to make sure that you're where your control layers are at the top of your curtain wall system. That you'll see there's a call out for the extruded silicone sheet to bridge that 3-inch gap and tie in and connect to your innermost seal. At the precast concrete, and then you'll also see at the backside once we get above the floor line, we've got the spray foam on the back there. So that's sort of how we'd approach a head detail using precast with dual stage joints, so rain screen joints, and then tying into a curtain wall at the head with the silicone sheet, giving you enough space to get that curtain wall into place. Air tightness with rigid foam, we don't usually rely on it as the main air barrier for our precast systems. That's what the dual stage joints are for, but it is definitely supplemental. It does increase the air tightness of your systems. And it is important that it creates, you know, the rigid foam air barrier on the backside, like we talked earlier, to prevent condensation on the interior side of your mass walls. Touching briefly on vapor barriers, really the main thing that I wanted to bring up is that rigid foam is usually closed cell, and concrete at given thicknesses is also a vapor retarder. We'll want to use your foam, whether it's in a sandwich or whether it's on the inboard side of your concrete, as your vapor control layer. And so one thing to try to sometimes avoid is putting an additional vapor retarder on the inboard side of a furred wall. Just the foam itself is usually enough for vapor control. And that sort of takes us through control layer considerations. And now I'm just going to talk a little bit about strategies. Rather than saying high level and detailed, I wanted to use coarse grain and fine grain. And the funny part, it reminded me of a joke, when I was in college, I used to work at a concrete plant, and I was in the aggregates lab, and it was also a gravel pit. And I always have a tendency to say things are fine, like when they're okay. And I'd have to radio out to the guys in the loaders that are actually mining the aggregates to make the concrete mixes. And they'd be like, how does the mix look? How does the concrete sound look? Are we in spec, right? And I'd always be like, yeah, it's fine. And there are at least once where I would say that over the thing, and they thought that I said it was too fine. So they just took a whole bunch of coarse aggregate and threw that into the concrete sand. And for a few hours, we made a whole bunch of really bad aggregate that we had to then throw out. So got to be very careful with words sometimes. But at the coarse level, at the high level, right? I want to sort of talk about when you're looking at exposed architectural concrete and you're trying to develop like a moisture control strategy for your exposed architectural concrete. What are some of the considerations that are going to drive that decision making? Because not every building's the same, not every wall's the same. I like this example of the population health facility as a good example for some material selection with exposed concrete, because it was pretty deliberate. The university is sensitive about on new projects having exposed architectural concrete. But we wanted to sort of, as a design team, celebrate these columns and make them features of the building. And then, so it becomes a conversation about risk, right? How risky is it to leave these columns, which are exposed and they are part of the enclosure, to leave them unpainted and exposed, particularly when there is some sensitivity about exposed architectural concrete? Well, one thing to keep in mind with these columns is these aren't huge walls, right? They're not big and large in areas. They're fairly focused. There's a lot of rebar in them. They have an overhang protection, right? That's the facade is protecting. These are down at the low level on the elevations. They're protected from some overhang. They're sure it's high and sure they'll see some water, but they're not going to be regularly soaked based on where they are on the elevations. They're only vertical elements. You can kind of see we actually clad all of the stem walls in between. So they're not connected to each other. There's cladding on all the lower parts. There's no horizontal projections. The stem wall's clad. We've got waterproofing on it. There's no cold joints or penetrations visible. And these are the sort of things that you want to walk through at a very high level of like evaluating risk. So this is pretty low risk. So going without a water control layer was something we did. We also split the columns and did a split assembly just for thermal comfort, but we were comfortable with these columns as they were based on all of these kind of factors. So it's not really a kind of never expose your concrete sort of thing. It's there are times when the risk can be managed. There's never no risk to it, but this is a good example of a time when it's manageable. This is another sort of lower risk element. Again, precast concrete is a high quality material. It's factory grade. You don't have the cold joints. This is a tower in Bellevue we recently completed. There's very little facade modulation. Where I've run into challenges and on old buildings with precast, it's when you've got all sorts of intersecting planes and there's a lot of facade modulations, but this is literally the core of the building. Not a lot of facade modulation, not a lot of huge like horizontal elements. You can sort of see down at the podium, there's some horizontal elements, but really not, not too much and not of high exposure. You know, we had dual stage joints, above the podium on the higher parts of the buildings. It's really only mostly vertical concrete. We had spray foam on the backside, no cold joints, no penetrations on this concrete. So in looking at this, again, this is a pretty low risk area. So using the concrete itself as the water control layer is a pretty suitable approach. You can get into areas where this is now cast in place concrete. This is a building in South Lake Union we worked on. The sort of board formed look is very important. But again, it's right at the base of a building. There's some overhang protection. It's low on the elevation. It's primarily at vertical elements. It had small, it's small in area. The cold joints that we had were all limited to stem walls. We actually poured these. These were independently poured from the structure above, so they weren't constrained on top and bottom. And the thing is, and you can kind of see along the base, the big consideration then is the connecting stem walls. But once you get above that sort of base of wall area, you know, above 2 feet, that was pretty low risk. We did all of these as monolithic pours with no cold joints, but then the infill walls were, we were very adamant about sort of crack control and making sure that we had things protected. But then things can kind of get progressively more risky, right? This is a building, coastal building, a homeowner, like a private residence. The concrete goes all the way up to the top of the building, no overhang protection. It's got that coastal exposure, lots of concrete on the wall area. And you can see there's re-entrant corners. There's a lot going on with this concrete. So with this building, leaving it exposed on its own, it was very important to the project, but the risk and the need for a more conservative approach to water control was deemed appropriate. And so this building has a split assembly with two layers of concrete and waterproofing behind that outer layer. So some of the things to kind of walk through is there overhang protection? How high on the elevation is your concrete exposure? Do you have horizontal elements? Is the base of wall, well sloped and drained? Do you have those four Ds in addition to, your placement of your concrete? And then do you have these long runs? Do you have stress concentrations, like re-entrant corners, things that will cause the building to crack? And sometimes we often see concrete, on the outside of a parking garage because it's at podium, sometimes leaving that exposed because you can maintain the interior because there's no interior finishes is a risk decision that teams need to walk through. All right, going through some of the detail levels. So when you're doing exposed concrete, this is a big one, right? This is where shrinkage cracks commonly occur. You've got this sort of pilaster. Whether it's a column, and then you've got stem walls that frame into it, your fenestration's often recessed, your sill membranes, how that turns up the jam can sometimes be unsightly. So we usually see very small upturns asked for there. Oh, I'm going to be out of order. The waterproofing is often at the base of this, and it often starts, below. So you're going to be out of plane with your, if you have like waterproofing on the backside, like a crystalline slurry, it's going to be out of plane with your below grade waterproofing. So these are all considerations. Sometimes the safest thing is to consider cladding your stem wall and to avoid having a sky facing concrete. Getting a bit of cladding on there, these stem walls aren't usually features of the building, it's more of the column, but having the cladding there, that's a good consideration. When you've got a split wall, and this is another building, this project's up in Whistler, there's less of an approach, right? So this is kind of like how we'd want to do it. You can see on the far right there, because of the split wall, we've got hot rubber that runs in and behind the outer board formed concrete. And then we've got like a stem wall with waterproofing that's going to run all the way up and a full waterproofed sill pan at the base. So this is a a lower risk detail when you've got the double walls and the cladding. And again, this is a private residence up in Whistler. They have the budget to do this, but they have also a lot of exposure. And so it's prudent to and bang for their buck to have the concrete done this way. The other thing to keep in mind is if you are relying largely on water stops for your water control, that if you've got openings, particularly at, you know, doors and windows, that you have to, the water stops require concrete cover. And so that creates a gap. You know, whenever we're talking about water control, if you're relying somewhat on water stops for water control, you know, what's happening at these areas? And then they can be risks if you're just relying on water stops, because you got to hold it back from that edge and you've got that discontinuity in your water stop. So if you are going with exposed concrete, it can be vulnerable. Form ties and penetrations. If you're casting in place, water stops can be pretty effective. If you are coring after the fact, it takes a little bit more nuance, right? Cores are often circular and oversized, right? If you're doing exposed concrete, there's no surrounding membrane to sort of tie into. You can't use water stop at a core. It is good to understand the geometry of penetrations that you're going to need if you're going to have a concrete wall, and basically design for that into the pore if you can, and try and make it so that you can get a backer rod and sealant joint around the shape of whether it's a wall hydrant or a pipe that gets cored after the fact. Just try to make sure you can get a backer rod. You can try to cover that. So ultimately this will get a plate that hides all of the workings behind, and then hit the backside with some closed cell spray foam. The other thing, this is a steel project with some architectural exposed concrete. You know, our buildings move. So a really important thing is to make sure that we're accounting for the fact that if you're connecting at the top, or how you connect at the top of the wall, it can induce stresses on your concrete that cause it to crack. So here, this building, what we ended up doing, we had a sort of a feature concrete wall at the entrances, but it's a steel deck at level two, and we had drift connections and had a drift joint that allowed clearance so that this concrete wall was not going to have stresses imposed on it by the movement of the steel structure behind. It's pretty evident in steel frame structures, PT decks that tend to shrink and contract. This detail here, by allowing these drift joints, you can allow for deflection and drift, and you're not over constraining the concrete walls. Transition at bases. You know, there's different ways to do it, some more durable than others. You know, on the left, you know, stopping the concrete right below your finishes and your hardscape. If you can raise that up slightly, you're improving the durability. If you can raise it up higher, you're getting it even better. A lot of the times when we've got precast or double stage walls, we're actually just running the membrane up on a curb behind, which is on the far right there. And you can see it gets you a higher level of durability when you're transitioning down at the base. Just to sort of give an example of that. So here's, you know, this is one thing to discuss. This isn't the cleanest look when you have the base flashings. Exposed. This is going to be a planter ultimately, but having these joints come up above the level of either your soil or your plantings, get the stainless flashing along the base. This here is how it looks when you're pre-stripping under a dual stage wall. This is that we saw the after photos. This is the residence up in Whistler. So you can get the concrete, or you can get waterproofing up and behind onto the wall. And then you pour the finished wall in front. Transitions at roofing is very important. This is a 60s building on the East Coast. And if you've got textured fluted concrete and you're tying a roof in, this detail here is probably one of the more biggest culprits in why they are like demolishing a lot of brutalist buildings. So getting these transitions are really hard to do if they're not planned in advance. And you know, some of the reasons cited for some of the demolition, like the demolition of the Orange County Government Center, for example, is that they just couldn't get the roof details to work with the textured concrete. And so they're perennially having roof leaks. And you can see this. This is actually at SUNY Stony Brook. We had, you walk up there and they just fill these holes with sealants all the way along. And then the turn bar just runs clean in front. And it's really hard to get. With planning, you can get around that. So transitions at roofing, especially textured concrete, if you have a smooth transition and a planned recess at the concrete, even if you're not doing a dual stage wall, that'll buy you so much more durability by planning the roof upturns and planning for a recess into the concrete that bypasses the texture. Textured concrete, this is a mock-up where there was a plan for them to leave the concrete smooth at the sides, and you know, you only pour concrete once, and so they didn't get the smooth concrete, and you can kind of see in the right there, it makes it very difficult to detail the waterproofing at your rough openings when you have textured concrete that goes too far. So planning out all of that is important, and especially as enclosure consultants, because we're often arriving on site after concrete has poured when they start doing waterproofing. So the mock-ups are important, but also making sure you're looking ahead in the design to sort of build this accommodation for textures out, because you know, some of the things that were walked through is, hey, well, what if we do this and we just parge, you know, the flute smooth, but what you're gonna get is you're just gonna get micro cracking all the way through that allows water to just bypass your waterproofing. So if you can also not only smooth it out, but also recess your upturns so that you don't have just like you basically have a cove for any upturns you're doing, it can look cleaner and it can terminate your waterproofing a little bit better. All right, so though that's sort of the design. Let's just touch a little bit on durability. I see where I'm at in time and I wanna be cognizant of everyone's time. So let's do a little bit of, you know, we do need to take care of these buildings. You know, the refurbishing and restoring existing exposed concrete buildings is super important, but also knowing how they fail is how we, you know, how we design more durably. So how does corrosion work at a really high level, right? It's the major driver of deterioration, right? So when you cast reinforcing steel into concrete, it passivates, right? There's an alkaline bath of the concrete surrounding the steel that prevents corrosion on its own. But cracks in the concrete can expose the passivation layer to faster deterioration. So once you expose that passivation layer of the slight little bit of like patina that forms on the reinforcing, and you introduce water and electrolyte, it'll soon remove the passivation, and that's when you start to see corrosion. Okay, what ends up happening, the telltale signs are that steel roughly expands in an 8-to-1 ratio, right? So for every eighth of an inch loss of steel, you get an inch of expansion in cross section, so that steel starts just pushing on your concrete and causing your spalling. But it's a feedback loop. So once the spalls occurred, more cracks open up, more water gets in, the corrosion happens faster. So as soon as you start seeing the spalling, you're just seeing the early form, and it will accelerate over time. There are other things like inadequate concrete cover and carbonation and contamination that can also speed up the rate of corrosion. One of the big things you can do is crack control is the first line of defense, and concrete cover. But also understanding what's causing cracking is a good way to, you know, to prevent corrosion. Because you can see this photo on the left here is an exposed concrete pilaster where they didn't really understand what was causing the cracking. So they were just sealing the cracks, and they were sealing the cracks for years and years and years. And actually, it was a roof leak from the backside that was corroding the column out from the back, and it rusted all the way through the rebars, and these column capitals were about to fall in the street. The other sort of corrosion prevention lesson is make sure you're not trapping water. The one on the right is it's actually a garage, it's not a wall, but I think it's a really important thing to think about is this is actually a repair that failed. And what happened is they used epoxy bonding agents on the underside of a deck, and then they had an impermeable coating. And what they did is they ended up creating an impermeable surface on the underside of a concrete deck. And if you trap moisture, the corrosion is still gonna go or still gonna continue. And the whole thing started, the whole ceiling started to just fall off over time. So making sure that your repairs aren't trapping water is a major thing to consider. The other driver of concrete deterioration is freeze-thaw. So this is on the right, this is a freeze-thaw plaza deck in New Jersey. And, just like beer bottle in the fridge or beer bottle in the freezer, water crystallizes and expands when it freezes. Air entrainment is the main method for freeze-thaw resistance, but even air entrained concrete, when it saturates, can be prone to freeze-thaw. Thankfully, it takes several degrees below freezing to actually have a freeze-thaw cycle. Usually, I think, at least with masonry, it's like 25 degrees Fahrenheit, and we don't see it that much. And when we do see it, our air actually dries out quite rapidly beforehand. So what we've sort of seen is the freeze-thaw on vertical elements here is not as drastic as we see it elsewhere in cold climates. But when these falls do occur, they start to accelerate corrosion by virtue of introducing more water to the reinforcing steel and getting rid of that passivation. Chloride ions, they used to have mixes that had like chloride ions in them. Nowadays, de-icing salts are one thing, but also the marine atmosphere. Where we live in the Pacific Northwest, we have salt in our air. And as concrete ages and poor quality concrete can be at risk from accumulating chlorides over time that can attack the reinforcing steel. Carbonation is something that we don't talk about a whole ton, but is a thing that to consider. A lot of our concrete buildings in Seattle are fairly new, but carbonation is a thing to keep in mind. So over time, concrete reacts with carbon dioxide and it forms calcium carbonate. And that calcium carbonate lowers the alkalinity of the concrete. Now, what ends up happening is by carbonating it, the steel starts to lose its passivation layers, and it works from the outside in, and it's not reversible. And the depth just increases over time. And basically, you can measure the depth of carbonation using phenolphthalein, which is kind of an indicator. It turns the concrete pink if it's still alkaline. And you need to measure the depth that you get. And once that carbonation depth reaches the steel, your passivation is lost and your corrosion risk goes way up. There's various things that drive it. Atmosphere, moisture content, the concrete cover, and the quality. But once you mix this with chloride contamination, that's when concrete really gets attacked. Exposed concrete will start to fall apart if you have chloride contamination coupled with carbonation. Here, thankfully, our buildings seem to be carbonating at a little bit of a slower rate. So this is East Coast Concrete, about a building that was having carbonation problems, and it was about 42 years old when I was looking at it. And this rebar had some good cover, but I've actually got a later photo where the concrete's closer to the surface and it's in the carbonation zone. And you're seeing spalling happen. And then we're getting, a depth of eighth of an inch to a quarter of an inch. This is a West Coast building that we were looking at, about the same age, and it had very, very, very little. So there are theories that the carbonation is driven a lot by like pollution and smog and places that have acid rain. And thankfully, because of our clean air, our exposed concrete is actually carbonating at a little bit of a slower rate.
That East Coast isn't related to like road salts or anything?
Road salts is more chloride contamination. Carbonation is an atmospheric thing. Yeah. So it's the carbonation actually happens uniformly around the building because it's airborne carbon dioxide.
Okay.
The other little sort of attack agent to keep an eye out for is alkali aggregate reaction. So alkali silica, SR and ACR. And they're actually a reaction that occurs between the aggregates and the alkali hydroxides. And what they do is they form a silica gel within the concrete. So what ends up happening is you get this gel that starts pushing the same way corroding reinforcing does, but it's a little closer to the surface, and you get these. This is when you see concrete that has the micro cracking and the alligatoring on its surface. And that's usually a gel from the aggregates that's reacting. And it's there aren't really great treatments. It all comes down to what kind of aggregates and where you're getting your aggregates from, because some aggregates, I think, you know, quartz is one of them, reacts a lot faster, and some aggregates don't. So this is more on the mixed design side of things and on the concrete plans and, you know, the guys in the gravel pits, making sure that they're aware of what kinds of aggregates they're harvesting. There aren't really cures available for it, but silane sealers, when you do start seeing, you know, these crack networks and the alligatoring cracks opening up, silane sealers can mitigate it. I've also used like lithium, but I've heard that it may or may not actually, a lithium topical treatment may not be all that effective. Okay, so mortar repair tips. I'm trying to wrap up shortly. I'm cognizant of everyone's time. Not all concrete repair mortars are the same. A lot of them are developed for things like roads and, you know, parking garages. But with architectural concretes, aesthetics is super important. So, my old firm back on the East Coast, we were restoring the building, like the Yale Art and Architecture building. And we went through this whole process of making sure we got a petrographic analysis, and you can match the existing concrete mix and placement techniques. And doing that will get you probably the best aesthetic match. So you can find like the sand profile, the aggregate profile, and place it in the same way. And that's, you know, forget like color additives or anything like that. The aggregates and the placement technique are the ways to get, you know, the best match mix. The other thing to consider adding to these mix, you can get migrating corrosion inhibitors. Shrinkage reducing admixtures are super important because concrete wants to shrink a little bit, and in a patch, you got to reduce that to avoid cracking, and keeping a low water cement ratio. And obviously having reinforcing in your patches. All right, and I'm just going to wrap up with an against exposed concrete, and this is just to talk about climate, right? This is from the IAEA report. That's basically, I mean, we've got a big job to do in the design world. We need to have by 2030 all new buildings being zero carbon ready. That's a hefty goal, right? And these are benchmark targets that we need to hit in order to avoid a Fahrenheit and a half degree rise by 2050. And so by 2040, to stay on track, we need to retrofit half of our existing buildings to zero carbon energy levels. So that's our climate is changing. And concrete is a major, major contributor to carbon footprint. It's the main source of embodied carbon. It's responsible for 8 to 12% of global emissions. Between concrete, steel, and chemical manufacturing, it's 60% of all industrial energy consumption. And the big thing is that deep emission reductions, there's not really low-hanging fruit other than material efficiency right now. So this is a photo of an advanced plant in Wisconsin. And the really green thing they're doing is burning tires instead of burning coal. So you can actually see the tires going up the ramp. And incinerating tires is one of the greener ways to make cement. It's just requires so much energy and such high temperatures that really deep emission reductions aren't like very viable right now. So the best path is to not use concrete when we don't need to use concrete. The other thing to keep in mind is that a changing climate is going to accelerate the deterioration of exposed concrete structures. Warmer atmospheres hold more water. Higher humidity levels in marine climates like Seattle will have more atmospheric chlorides. The atmospheric CO2 concentration is also going to go up, and that's going to increase the rate that carbonation occurs in exposed concrete. So over time, these buildings are going to carbonize faster, and we're going to have more chlorides in our atmosphere. And this combination is not going to be good for concrete if left exposed in the long term. But retrofits matter, right? retrofitting existing buildings is the way to decarbonize. It's the most significant way to decarbonize the built environment. It's the biggest feasibility constraint. We have a ton of existing buildings. Retrofitting our existing building stock is the way to hit our targets for climate change. In order to hit that target, we need that half of existing buildings and a third of existing buildings in developing countries by 2030. This is a great example. I used to live in New Haven for a while. This is the Pirelli building. Like many brutalist buildings, it was vacant for years. It was vacant when I left. It was a vacant building in the IKEA parking lot. And it's now, like this year, it's opening up. It's been retrofitted to passive house standards. They've kept the existing building structure. There are ways to keep and maintain the existing brutalist buildings and make them energy efficient. And thermal efficiency retrofits are a massive way to reduce our emissions over time. So in summary, let's give the existing brutalist buildings that we have some more TLC. Let's retrofit them. Let's keep them around. Let's show them some love. But to be brutally honest, there are often some better performing alternatives to using exposed architectural concrete. And I thank everyone for your time. I do, you know, love this topic and happy to talk about it now, or if you want to reach out to me later, I'm always available. Thank you so much.
Yeah, Brad, thank you so much. That was really great.
Excellent. Thank you.
This is definitely a topic that needed coverage, and we appreciate the depth that you went into. I don't have any open questions. So if folks do have anything you want to slip in over the transom before we depart, please do. As I mentioned previously, our next presentation is by Patricia Shaw about aspirations and actual achievements in rain screen designs. So we look forward to seeing you all back in May. In June, we'll have the Christine Williams from Building Design Fight Club to give us a presentation. If you follow her on Instagram, it's a really kind of fun and informative conversation. One question here, what was the orange-red colored waterproofing? Is that just Argard or was that?
I think it was Argard. That is-
It looked really vivid.
Yes, that was Scott's, another person from our office's project. So he and I were talking a bit more about it this morning. I know they used like a SIGA membrane on the walls, and I think it was Argard along those sills because it was tying into hot rubber at the decks and at those like split areas. So I think that it just looks vivid, right? But yeah, I think that's just fast flash there.
Okay. You didn't mention like ultra high performance concrete and
yes. Those pieces? That's a good question. Yeah. So, and are you referring to like the thin shell panels?
Yeah.
No, I like the, like they're, the, I haven't looked at them too much from we are using them on some buildings as a cladding panel. They do come in great textures. I haven't looked at the like carbon side of their like cement production, but they are really cool and really durable panel.
It's not nearly as much cement as
correct. Yes, and not requiring as much structure, and still can achieve that effect. That is a good point. I'll try and get some photos of that, and you know, for the next time I do this, I think that's a good one because the panels look great. And the textures that come with them are good. And it is a good alternative to exposed architectural concrete. Tactile. And yeah.
Great. Well, thanks again. Thanks to Mike Fletcher and EPRO for sponsoring the meeting. And after the next two presentations, we'll have our summer break. And we're hoping to get back to in-person meetings in the fall. Wow.
All right. Thanks, everyone. Thanks very much, everyone.
Thanks, Brad. Everybody have a good night.
Bye.